But I think it will be a good thing. I was hoping we could do an outdoor service because it's a beautiful day, but because we already started coming in, I felt for consistency's sake, you would just come in, do the service inside. It's a good weather though, so after the service, you might use outdoors to chat with one another and visit. I have no other, well, you can, as you can see, the seats are arranged in such a way that you are 6 feet away from the person next to you. If there are suggestions, if you have any suggestions as to how we can do it better, please let us know. Let me know, and maybe let the ushers know as well. Because we are in this for the long haul, as you have heard from our the scientists who are working hard during this time. I think that's about it. There will be more announcements later, but I thought I'd just begin with those. Purify ourselves as he is pure, that when he comes again with power and great glory, we may be made like him in his eternal and glorious kingdom, where he lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
A reading from the book of Amos. Thus says the Lord, the God of hosts, the Lord, alas, for you who desire the day of the Lord, why do you want the day of the Lord? It's darkness, not light. As if someone fled from a lion and was met by a bear, or went into the house and rested a hand against the wall and was bitten by a snake. Is not the day of the Lord darkness, not light, and gloom with no brightness in it? I despise your festivals, and I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer your burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. And the offerings of well-being of your fatted animals, I will not look upon. Take away from me the noise of your songs. I will not listen to the melody of your harps. But let justice roll down the waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. The word of the Lord.
Thanks
be to God. The psalm today is number 70, which can be found in your bulletin. The psalm will be read responsively by full verse. The congregation will read the bolded verses. Be pleased, O God, to deliver me. O Lord, make haste to help me.
Let those who seek my life be ashamed and altogether dismayed. Let those who take pleasure in my misfortune draw back and be disgraced.
Let those who say to me, aha, and gloat over me, turn back, because they are ashamed.
Let all who see who you truly are be glad at you. Let those who love your salvation say forever, great is the Lord.
But as for me, I am poor and needy. Come to me speedily, O God.
You are my helper and my deliverer. O Lord, you have not forgotten.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Philippians. We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. For this we declare to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will by no means precede those who have died. For the Lord himself, with a cry and command, with the archangel's call, and with the sound of God's trumpet, will descend from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. The word of the Lord.
Then the kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were foolish, and five were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them. But the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a shout, "Look, here is the bridegroom. Come out to meet him." Then all those bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise replied, "No, there will not be enough for you and for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves." And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he replied, "Truly I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour." Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. The theme of waiting and readiness in our lessons today remind us that Advent is creeping in on us. The 28th, I think, is the first, is Advent Sunday, so that's what, 3 Sundays from today. In a way, during this COVID time, we have been in a kind of Advent, waiting to return to normal life for some, and for others, preparing for what is to come, a new normal or a new way of life. I think the themes of waiting and preparing are difficult in a culture such as ours, a culture that tells us that waiting is not a very good thing. I am reminded of the commercials on television or the internet, where the commercials are all about speed and rapid response. I doubt most of us can even relate to the days without cell phones now. Now my phone also keeps me connected to email, so I don't have to wait until I am near a computer to learn about my emails. Our culture does not wait for anything, or at least we don't like to wait for anything. That might be an exaggeration on my part, but you know what I mean, right? And so we don't really know how to look forward to things, let alone wait patiently for them. In a lot of ways, our patience is being tested. Despite all these, despite our impatience and desire for instant gratification, God's way of relating to us has not changed. God does things on God's time, not on our time. Actually, that is a good thing, though that is sometimes difficult for us to see. Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians is a case in point. The letter is actually the oldest writing in the New Testament. I pointed that out some sermons ago. It was written before any of the Gospels were thought to have been written, and before any of Paul's other writings. And what is the topic of this letter? It is essentially about waiting. The church in Thessalonica was one of the first churches Paul established. The Thessalonian church was confused with a crisis. People were starting to die, and Jesus has not returned. This may not sound like a problem to us, but to Jesus' earliest followers and to the new Christian communities that Paul had established, it was a big problem. It was a problem because Jesus' earliest followers evidently expected Jesus to return soon.
and bring an end to the old order. When Jesus returned, the powers that would be destroyed, and God would be the sovereign ruler of the world. But what about those who already died? What happens to them? Paul's answer to the Thessalonians is the answer most of us have received down through the ages. His answer is that those who die believing in the Lord Jesus will be raised up when Jesus returns in glory. Of course, we don't know when that is going to happen. Paul and Jesus' earliest followers surely thought it would be sooner rather than later. I am sure they would never have believed that God would wait as long as God has now waited. But by the end of his life, Paul seemed to believe that he would die before Christ returned. And that was probably a change for him and from his earliest belief, which was probably that Jesus would return at any moment. The thing that I find most interesting about the way Paul handles this crisis is that it does not shake his faith. Whose faith has been shaken during this pandemic? God does not seem to be acting in accordance with the expected timeline. And yet Paul does not find that a reason to question his faith or entertain doubts. Rather, Paul trusts God, and his trust tells him that God will do things as God desires, not as he, Paul, desires as others desire. That is one of the reasons I find Paul admirable. As you know, the theme of this week's gospel is also about waiting. But Jesus' parable introduces a new wrinkle. It is not just a matter of waiting patiently or faithfully. All the bridesmaids are patient and faithful. Nor is it simply a matter of staying awake, although there is a counsel given at the end of the gospel, because we are told that all of them became drowsy and slept. Instead, the quality that Jesus wants to emphasize is waiting wisely. And wisdom, in this case, means being prepared. I'm sure you're familiar with this gospel already. And one objection I often hear, and I wondered about myself, was why the five wise bridesmaids would not share with the foolish bridesmaids. It doesn't seem very Christian for them to be so selfish. But Jesus' focus is not on sharing, but on being prepared. He wants his followers, the community that he has brought together, to be wise. He wants them to be committed to waiting as long as it takes, and to be prepared for the long haul. And being prepared for the long haul means not taking things for granted, but rather being prepared. Although the focus of Jesus' parable is slightly different from Paul's, the underlying point is the same. We should not expect that God will do things according to our timeline or our desires. God will do what God will do and when God will do it. For many of us, this point may be very difficult. Intellectually, we know that God is God and we are not. But it is often difficult to keep that in mind as we go about our day-to-day life. I often catch myself, probably more often than not, God's children, as the college tells us today. But even more than that, we are God's instruments or agents, as it were. So we must wait for God and wait for God to act. But in our very waiting for God, we may discover that God is not absent. In a mysterious way, as I wait for God, God is right there, right there, here with us. As we wait for God, we can imagine God waiting for us and wondering, when is she going to wake up and see that I am right here? When are the human beings going to stop fighting with one another and realize that I am waiting for them to change their ways? So, this week perhaps we can spend some time reflecting on how God is in our lives already, and how we might make our lives even more hospitable for God, more open, giving God more space than just taking all of the space all for ourselves. Because it is God's life. So let's spend the week. My invitation is to spend the week ahead waiting at the same time watching and paying attention for God's presence in our lives. Paying attention to how is God present with us right now, here and now? That would be the question that to keep in mind wherever you are, whatever you're doing. How is God present with me right now? How do I feel it? How do I see it? Even if I don't see it, do I believe that? That God is with me right here, right now. So let's take a minute, 2 minutes of silence. I invite you to become aware of what stands out for you right now, and how do you feel about that?
Say the Nicene Creed together. We believe in one God,
Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God,
Let us pray to the Lord for the Church of God that we may be filled, with love, generosity, and truth to transform our community and our world.
May your light
shine through us.
For the leaders of our nation and the leaders of all nations.
May your light instill in them compassion and good judgment and guide them in the ways of justice and peace.
For all who hold authority in our church, that they may shine your light rightly.
May your spirit inspire them, create creativity, renew their energy, and give them wisdom and love.
For blessing on all our human endeavors and for the just and proper use of the beauty and abundance of creation.
May each of us well and serve you in ways that shine your light in our communities and beyond to create a world of poverty, famine, and oppression.
For the sick in body, mind, or spirit, especially Jim, Andrew, Kenneth, Terry, Norman, William, Joanne, Ben, Norma, Teresa, Alyssa, Peter, David, Dara, Rena, Karen, Pam, Edna, Jeff, Larry, Lisa, Lindsay, Ruth, John, Nathan, Bennett, Dorothy, April, Avery, Ralph, Pat, Kathy, Matthew, Jonathan, Nate, and April. And for those we now name in our hearts.
May your light bring hope.
For all who have died and for those who grieve, especially Stephen and Maria, and for those we now name in our hearts.
For Cynthia's mother, Margie, who died on Thursday, may her royal soul and souls of those departed rest in peace. For all of them died from the coronavirus. May your perpetual light shine on all the saints who have gone before us.
O God, in your infinite generosity, you have made it a world of resources to sustain all of your children with the abilities of food, work, and recreation. Help us to light our lives shine so brightly that the whole world can witness your glory. In the name of Jesus, we pray.
I would like to add this prayer. Grant, O God, that your holy and life-giving spirit may so move every human heart, that barriers which divide us may crumble, suspicions disappear, and hatred cease, that our divisions being healed, we may live in justice and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us not confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, or deed, by what we have done, by what we have done.
Amen. May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
You may be. Hello? Hello?
Hello?
You're not on.
There you go. A few more announcements. Susan is a couple, but for communion, the section here has signs on the floor for when we fall in line to come for communion, and we will do it by section, starting with, we're calling this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Section 1 will come ahead. So you can see those spots, signs on the floor. Before you move, of course, to the next line, wait for the other person to leave. But as already instructed before, you cut your hands to receive the bread, carry it to your seat, lift up the bottom of your mask, and consume the bread that way. So after you receive it from here, you go down the middle aisle and back to your seat. Same for this aisle, for this section here, okay? So I think that's all I have. Susan?
Morning. Yesterday was the 237th convention of the Diocese of Pennsylvania. It was a little different yesterday because it was virtual. It took quite an undertaking on the part of the diocese to set this up. Think about it. Over 300 people were logged in to view the presentations. But the other thing they had to arrange was how to vote. There was no mail-in voting, no provisional voting yesterday at the convention. We had to vote electronically. So that meant each registrant had to receive their own unique voter ID. So I can't imagine all of the technical difficulties and problems that they had to resolve for, I'm sure, months. But it seemed to go smoothly. Claire, Karen, Matt, and I attended two pre-convention meetings just so we could get it right. So Claire and I set up on my kitchen or my dining room table, and she bought, I think, every electronic device she owned. Her smartphone, her iPad, and her laptop. But we got it done, okay? We voted electronically for various candidates to be elected to the Board of Trustees, the Church Attorney, various commissions, and deputies to the General Convention, which will be held in 2021. Our own Dave Dixon was elected to the Board of Trustees. So congratulations. The two other resolutions we voted on were the budget for 2021 and also the clergy compensation. Happily, there were not a lot of issues that we had to vote on this year, so it was a pretty smooth time that we spent at the convention. It was wonderful that they were able to get this virtual convention on board. But to be honest, I really missed being in the cathedral with all of these other Episcopalians, lay and clergy. I miss singing and worshiping with all of them, and I miss seeing other friends from other parishes. But this is 2020, so this is a reality. So let's see what happens for next year. Now, my other announcement is for Christmas wreaths. This year, we're doing it ourselves. We're not working.
more likely to find mason jars liberally strewn around the barn venue and handwritten chalkboards offering tri-tip, which you can eat perched on a bale of hay. But the frenetic last-minute energy of things needing to be fixed is just the same today as in Scripture. If you get stuck in the anxiety, keeping company with the wedding planner and their staff, you are going to miss the point of the event. Weddings confer the blessing of companionship. We can get stuck in the mechanics of delivery and all of the anxiety it generates, or we can acknowledge that love is a great gift and we should be grateful for it. I once oversaw a wedding in which a couple forgot to get a license. I took a deep breath, made sure they had a wonderful day, and secretly remarried them a month or two later. Their love for each other was a gift. We found a way to fix the paperwork. Faith is a gift. Christian community is a gift. Worship, children's choirs, and that moment when teenagers suddenly make a profound connection with their faith. These are all gifts. We could get caught up in the anxiety of paying for it all, or we could just say thank you and write the pledge that shows how grateful we are for all we have received. So this story reminds me of my own wedding, partially because we got our wedding license the day before the wedding. my husband and I had decided to forego the formal wedding, and instead we used our money to buy a house. So after the ceremony at St. Paul's, we had everyone back to the house for the reception, and it was a wonderful gathering of friends and family. So, as a couple, we had decided that the value of the gift of a home for our family over the glitz and glam of a formal wedding. So during the stewardship campaign, we are being asked to contemplate on what we personally value and the gifts we have received, and how we can continue to support our spiritual journey, outreach, and church family from the blessings of God.
Thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We
praise you and we bless you, holy and gracious God, source of life abundant. From before time you made ready the creation. Your spirit moved over the deep and brought all things into being. Sun, moon, and stars, earth, winds, and waters, and every living thing. You made us in your image and taught us to walk in your ways. But we rebelled against you and wandered far away. And yet as the mother cares for her children, you would not forget us. Time and again you called us to live in the fullness of your love. And so this day we join with saints and angels in the chorus of praise that rings through eternity, lifting our voices to magnify you as we say,
Holy, 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 holy Lord, God, our light, heaven and earth are full of your glory, the sun in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the sun in the highest.
Glory and honor and praise to you, holy and living God, to deliver us from the power of sin and death, and to reveal the riches of your grace. You look with favor upon Mary, your willing servant, that she might conceive and bear a son, Jesus, the Holy Child of God. Living among us, Jesus loved us. He broke bread with outcasts and sinners, healed the sick, and proclaimed good news to the poor. He yearned to draw all the world to himself, yet we were heedless of his call to walk in love. Then the time came for him to complete upon the cross the sacrifice of his life and to be glorified by you. On the night he died for us, Jesus was at the table with his friends. He took bread, gave thanks to you, and broke it, and gave it to them and said, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. As supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. Again he gave thanks to you, gave it to them and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me. Now gathered at your table, O God of all creation, and remembering Christ crucified and risen, who was and is and is to come, we offer to you our gifts of bread and wine and ourselves a living sacrifice. Pour out your spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the body of Christ, body and blood of Christ. Breathe your spirit over the whole earth and make us your new creation, the body of Christ given for the world you have made. In the fullness of time, bring us to the ever-blessed Virgin Mary and all your saints, from every tribe and language and people and nation, to feast at the banquet prepared from the foundation of the world. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise, forever and ever.
Amen.
Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. Forever and ever. Amen.
stand for a post-communion prayer. Let us pray. Eternal God,
Heavenly Father, you are gracious to accept us as living members of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and to give us spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Christ has no body now on earth but yours, no hands, no feet but yours. Yours are the eyes with which Christ looks out his compassion to the world. Yours are the feet with which he is to go about doing good. Yours are the hands with which he is to bless us now. And the blessing of God Almighty, Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier be with you now and always.
Amen.
Amen.